Hi, I'm Dr. Simon Freiler, consultant in clinical neurophysiology, and in this video I will talk about benign fasciculation syndrome, or BFS for short. Fasciculations are involuntary muscle twitches that can occur in both healthy people and in those with a wide variety of diseases. It is difficult to say just how common this condition is, but it is not rare and it is well described amongst health professionals. It is important to state that BFS is a diagnosis of exclusion, i.e. one needs to investigate other potential causes before making this diagnosis. However, there are a number of clinical pointers towards BFS rather than it being as a result of an underlying pathological condition. BFS tends to affect the muscles in the lower legs, hands and eyelids, and it can even cause twitching in the tongue and in the ear muscles, causing a beating sound to be heard and felt. The twitches tend to occur periodically, with some periods where the condition is more active than others, and also tends to flip between different muscle regions. In this video clip, you can see a patient's muscle twitching autonomously. It is quite irregular and arrhythmic and is occurring in one of the typical muscles to be affected in the hand. They can also be associated with cramps, myalgia, tingling, fatigue, anxiety, and the sensation of something being stuck in the throat called globus pharyngeus. The twitches may be exacerbated by tiredness and stress and can be partially interrupted by actively moving the muscles involved. The most important feature that needs to be checked for is that there should be no objective muscle weakness or wasting. If there is, it would argue against BFS, and the fasciculations would likely be secondary to another condition. It is generally accepted that fasciculations are due to an overexcitability of the nerves innervating the muscles. However, because the nervous system is both highly complex and involves long distances, it is proven difficult to provide categorical answers as to where exactly in the nervous system these fasciculations originate from. There is evidence of both spinal cord and peripheral nerve origins to the fasciculations in BFS. More recently, thanks to pioneers such as Professor Hugh Bostock, we've been better able to study nerve excitability. Individual ion channel dysfunctions, such as HCN, may play a role in inducing overexcitability of the nerves in BFS. Other conditions that can be associated with fasciculations include the following: reticulopathies and neuropathies, which can lead to nerve damage and dysfunction. Neuromuscular junction disturbances can also increase the probabilities of spontaneous contractions too. Metabolic causes such as hyperthyroidism and hyperparathyroidism can have primary or secondary effects. Electrolyte disturbances such as having raised potassium or low magnesium and calcium levels. Vitamin D deficiency can have secondary impact on calcium levels too. Stimulants such as drinking too much caffeine can also cause this. Medications that enhance the sympathetic nervous system with adrenaline-like substances such as epinephrine nasal sprays or amphetamines. Anticholinergic agents such as ipratropium and tiotropium that are used in asthmatic patients, or trihexyphenidate that may be used in Parkinson's disease, can also have these effects. Diuretics used in heart failure and ACE inhibitors in hypertension can alter potassium levels. Statins for raised cholesterol, isoniazid in TB, opiates and opiate withdrawal, and corticosteroid medications are all well described. Autoimmune conditions such as Isaac syndrome and certain spinocerebellar atrophy syndromes are also very rare causes of fasciculations. Of course, what commonly worries most patients and their physicians is potential motor neurone disease. Motor neurone disease is a progressive condition and is associated with clinical weakness and wasting of the muscles. In addition, fasciculations in motor neurone disease tend to be persistent, spread, and are found in adjacent areas rather than flitting between different areas. What is very important in these situations is neurophysiology studies using EMG to look for evidence of underlying denervation, which may be subclinical. You can see examples of fibrillations and fasciculations in the eye card above. The nature of the fasciculations can also be helpful, such as double fasciculations, though complex waveforms do not appear to be as diagnostic as previously thought in MND. Ultimately, time is the greatest discriminator, and once past the 4 or 5 year mark without additional signs, BFS is a fairly secure diagnosis. So, in terms of diagnosis, a good clinical history, looking for features listed above, going through all relevant medications, and a thorough clinical examination are all required to exclude alternative and more serious causes. Blood tests will be necessary to check electrolyte and metabolic disturbances, and where necessary, for autoimmune conditions. And of course, neurophysiology studies with nerve conduction tests and EMG are important screening tools as well. In time, nerve excitability studies may move on from being at more of a research basis type of test to become more mainstream, and as we continue to learn more about this condition, it may become increasingly important. Treatment is symptomatic and should be holistic, so if sleep deprivation and stress are contributory causes, these will need evaluation and will need to be addressed. Stress and anxiety are potent activators of the sympathetic nervous system, which drives the fight and flight response and nerve hyperexcitability. Stress management techniques can be helpful to ameliorate this. Caffeine and other stimulants should be avoided. Some patients can have this as a result of sleep apnea, which might need specific treatment. Any electrolyte disturbances or vitamin deficiencies will need screening for and correction, and any exacerbating medications should be discontinued where possible. There are certain medications such as carbamazepine, propranolol and verapamil which can help, though the benefits are often less than satisfactory and this condition tends to wax and wane anyway. There doesn't appear to be any long-term health consequences of having this condition. I hope that you found this video useful, and if so, please support this channel by subscribing and giving me a thumbs up. Many thanks.